Jesus, I know you make a way. And I don't always understand, I don't always get to see, but I will believe it, I will believe it. 'Cause you make mountains move, you make giants fall, and you use songs of praise to shake prison walls. And I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt, that you were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. I'm standing on your word, I'm calling heaven down to earth. And you use songs of praise to shake prison walls. And I will speak to my fear, oh, I will preach to my doubt. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. For you make mountains move, you make giants fall.
Hello, Harvest family. My name is Jeff Thompson. I get the privilege of serving as one of the pastors of our Chicago Cathedral campus, and I'm so excited that you've joined us online for church today. And whether Harvest is your church home or whether you're a first-time guest for us, we're really, really glad that you're here and that you're joining us. And I want to invite you to check in, to let us know that you're here. You can do that two different places. The first is the Harvest Bible Chapel app on your phone, or you can also check in on the website right above us at the top of the page where it says check in. This is a way that we're aware of your presence here with us today, that you're joining us, and a way that we can care for you in a better way going forward. Well, wherever you are, let's stand right now and let's worship the Lord together.
Son of God, all We've seen what you can do, oh God of wonders. Your power has no end. The things you've done before, in greater measure, you will do again.
That's right. Sing that again. Come on.
See what you can do, oh God of wonders. Your power has no end. The things you've done before, in greater measure, you will do again.
Come on.
'Cause there's no prison wall you can't break through, no mountain you can't move. All things are possible. And there's no broken body you can't raise, no soul that you can't save. All things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up. You can light it up. God of revival, let hope arise. Death is overcome. You've already won. God of revival, you rose in victory, and now you're seated forever on your throne.
That's right.
So why should my heart fear what you've defeated? I will trust in you alone. 'Cause there's no prison wall you can't break through, no mountain you can't move. All things are possible. And there's no broken body you can't raise, no soul that you can't save. All things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up.
Come on,
you can light it up. God of revival, let hope arise. Death is overcome. Already won. God of revival, you're the God of revival. Yes, you're the God of revival.
Come on, I believe this. Let's sing it.
Come awaken your people. Come awaken this city. Oh, God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. We'll hear the chains hit the ground. Oh, God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Come awaken your people. Come awaken this city. Oh, God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. We'll hear the chains hit the ground. God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. The darkest night, you can light it up. You can light it up. God of revival, let hope. Death is overcome. You've already won. God of revival. The darkest night, you can light it up. You can light it up. 'Cause you're the God of revival. Let hope arise. Death is overcome.
God of revival.
say yes, Lord.
To revive, we say
yes, Lord.
Come on, sing that with me.
So we say yes, Lord.
We say yes to revive.
Yes,
Lord. Sing that over your families.
So we say
yes, we say yes,
Lord.
We say yes.
Yes, Lord. So we say yes.
Over our homes we say,
Lord. Yes.
Come on, let's sing that again. Come on. And your family, sing that.
So we say yes.
Over our workplaces,
Lord,
over our finances, God,
yes,
over our brothers and sisters,
Lord,
over our church, God.
So we say yes, Lord.
We say
yes, Lord.
Thank you.
Stand and sing forevermore the honor and
That's right, Lord. Only you are worthy of this praise, worthy of these songs, worthy of the one who is called holy, 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 set apart, sovereign. It's you, God, that is receiving this praise in spirit and truth and through the name of your Son, who we worship and adore, Jesus. Amen and amen.
Well, as we continue in worship, I have just a few announcements for us. If you're like me, when you think summer camp. And we've been getting a lot of questions about Camp Harvest, so here's the latest. We're going to open up Camp Harvest in the month of July, first for family camp. So you can bring your whole family up and stay in a cabin together and experience all that's up there at Camp Harvest. These are going to be July 5th through the 8th, July 10th through the 13th, and July 14th through the 17th. And then our students will be up there. Our junior high students will be up July 19th through the 23rd, and our high school students July 25th through the 29th. And we're watching closely for the state guidelines of the state of Michigan and following those, which means that our student camps will be at about 50% capacity, and our family camps will be one family unit per cabin. We really want you to be able to get up to Camp Harvest and take advantage of these. And each of these events, the registration for them opens June 16th. So be watching for that. Well, men, I'm getting so excited about our men's event, Man of the House. And it's happening this coming weekend on the 12th Friday and the 13th Saturday. It is a free event and it's an online event. And we want you to get registered. We need you to be registered so that you can take part in all that God is gonna do in our midst. We're gonna be covering topics like purity and anxiety and relational conflict. We have breakouts planned where you'll be able to get with some brothers in Christ and encourage one another and challenge one another and pray for each other. We're going to be rooted in God's word and we're going to be lifting high the name of Jesus in worship. And so if you're not registered yet, you can do that at harvestbiblechapel.org/man of the house. Well, this summer we're kicking off a series of personal challenges to help us each grow in our love for the Lord. We're calling it a harvest summer, mind, body, and soul. We're going to be stretching our mind as we read important resources and wrestle with these things. We're going to be get our bodies moving and active to love the Lord in a greater way with our bodies. And we're going to be stretching and feeding our souls as we seek after the Lord in prayer and in His Word. And we're going to seek to grow in these things. I hope for you that this is the greatest summer of growth in the Lord for you. I'm praying for that for myself as well. And so you can see all of June's challenges by going to the website harvestbiblechapel.org/mind-body-soul. And much more is coming in July and August with more challenges so that we can continue to grow. Well, I get questions pretty much every day from people who are asking, you know, when can we be back at our campus? When can we join together in worship? I really miss it. Well, I miss it too. And I wanted to let you know that our leaders are still following the guidelines that we set forth in our May 26th update. You can find that online on our website if you want to read over that again and look at it. But we are going to continue to meet online for services like this throughout the month of June. And we want you to come back and join us each and every week throughout the month of June. We're looking for the opportunity to gather in the future. We're really praying and hoping to be able to do that soon. And as we plan for next steps, we're really seeking to gather data and to listen to you, to our church family. So would you do us a favor? Would you fill out a short survey? This survey is going to go out over email on Sunday afternoon, right after our services. You'll get that in the email, or you can go to harvestbiblechapel.org/survey and fill out this short survey. It really helps us plan the next steps in a healthy way and to care for you in the best way possible. We're hoping and praying for 100% participation so that we can care for you in the best way possible. So watch for that survey on Sunday afternoon or go to the website to fill that out. As we continue, would you join with me in prayer for our offering and also for our country? Father, we are amazed at the incredible love that you have granted to us because of Jesus Christ, that when we were dead in our trespasses and sins, you made us alive because of Jesus' death on the cross. God, that you've ransomed us and brought us into a right relationship with you, that you've cleansed us from all of the wrong that we have ever done or could ever do, that we are right before you. And Lord, we give you praise and glory because of that incredible miracle that you've performed in each one of us. And God, when we look at the landscape of our country and all of the difficult things that are going on in our land, the injustices that we see, God, it breaks our heart, and we know that it breaks your heart. So God, would you move in our land? Sometimes we don't even know what to pray for specifically, but would you work a miracle, Lord? We've seen a miracle in our own hearts, how you've cleansed us and redeemed us, and so we believe that you can do that in our land. God, would you do it for the good of our people? Would you do it for your glory? And Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to gather as a church family. We thank you for these tithes and these offerings. Lord, we bring them with grateful and generous hearts. Lord, we know that all of the things that you've done for us, that they just show that you own it all. And so, Lord, we give this back to you as a portion, just displaying that and telling you that we believe that all of this belongs to you. Lord, would you use it for your kingdom? Would you use it to bring men and women and children to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ for our good, for your glory? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Defender of my heart. Jesus, forever by my side.
Shake the mountains, so shake the mountains. Break the walls apart, open the heavens. Almighty God, you are overcomer, defender of my heart.
Father, we lift our eyes to the hills from where our help comes from. Our help comes from you, the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And we look to you for our breakthrough. We don't look at our situation. We don't look at our circumstance. We look to you. Cover our hearts. Give us strength to continually look to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, I'm just wondering if you have noticed a developing trend in our society these past couple of months. You see, the longer the pandemic continues, the more the coronavirus has become the scapegoat for everything. It's become our standard excuse for any mistake, miscue, or mishap. And you can blame anything on it, and people will buy it. COVID or corona has become the convenient culprit. And when the boss says, "Were you able to get the project done?" Well, the COVID thing has really thrown things off. Why did you stop your workout routine? The COVID virus. Honey, did you take the trash out? I couldn't find my face mask. Why were you late with your online and class assignment? Well, my laptop has a virus. I think it's COVID-19. Or on a Zoom call, a coworker says, "Oh, Maria, I see you're choosing to go gray." No, that's just 10 weeks of quarantine. Well, let's face it. For those of us who are married, you've experienced that the longer the quarantine goes on, the more vigilant you must be to not drop your guard and be insensitive. Maybe you saw this post that was making the rounds on social media. "Did I get fat during the quarantine?" the wife says. And the husband says, "Well, you never really were skinny." Time of death, 9:34 p.m. May 28th. Cause of death, COVID-19 virus. So the new scapegoat is COVID. Now, I can't say a whole lot because I gained 8 pounds during shelter in place. Well, today we're going to put COVID-19 in the rearview mirror. And for the next few minutes, I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles out, and I want you to turn in your Bible to Mark chapter 12. And we're going to walk through a passage of Scripture. And I'd like to just share a few thoughts on this season of racial tension in which we find ourselves after we've walked through Mark 12. And here in the Gospel of Mark, we're focusing on Christ as a bold servant. And in Mark 12, we're going to see more of his boldness than of his service. And today we will look at two different encounters with some people who were enemies of Christ, but who will experience firsthand the wisdom of Christ. And both of these encounters will be designed to trap Jesus by testing his knowledge of Scripture and testing his wisdom. But Jesus will be up for the challenge, and hopefully you will be too, when you find yourself in hostile settings or when the enemies of Christ set traps and pose difficult questions for you. So let's begin today by realizing that there is a difference between knowledge and wisdom. You've heard me say before that if you want knowledge, ask Siri. If you want wisdom, ask the Lord. Over in James chapter 1, let me just read this for you in verse 5. James writes this. He says, "If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him." So God wants to give you wisdom. So the question becomes, will you ask him for it? And here's our central theme for today. It's just simply this: pray for God to give you wisdom. And this has been a constant prayer of mine, as well as my wife, for many years. And we are desperate for God's wisdom. And so we will just pray on a regular basis and say, "Lord, give us your wisdom." And this has been a theme that goes on and on, because on my own, I'm not real smart. And later in that same chapter, in James chapter 1, verse 22, James says, "But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves." So you may have knowledge of what God says that you are to do or how you are to live, but that's not enough. Wisdom is when you put it into practice. And one who has wisdom will follow through, and they will have obedience. Knowledge is learned. Wisdom is lived. Knowledge is observation, but it's not wisdom unless it is coupled with logic or awareness. Let me illustrate that for you. Author Bruce Larson tells of being on a vacation with his family when they were traveling through California, and he saw a sign along the road that said, "Naturist Camp." And Larson writes, "Well, being lovers of God's creation, we turned in and we drove down the entrance road. But a little ways down the road, we were passed by five people on bicycles, each of which was stark naked. His observant young son said, 'Dad, did you see that?' And Larson cringed and stoically replied, 'Yes, son.' And again his son said, 'Dad, did you see that? None of them were wearing their helmets.'" His limited knowledge didn't tell the complete story. And like father, like son, because his dad's knowledge was lacking too, since he didn't know the difference between a naturist and a naturalist. Now, don't misunderstand me. There is nothing wrong with pursuing knowledge. That's a good thing, as long as, at the same time, you are pursuing God's wisdom. And in a world that wants to choose its own way and make its own rules and move its own direction, the Bible holds out for us an alternative that cannot be Googled. And its wisdom for us is not only helpful, but more importantly, it's true. And the words and the stories may be ancient, but they certainly are not irrelevant, because the Word of God is living. It is active. You see, you don't need to check your brain at the door when you become a Christian. Look at our text, Mark chapter 12. We will begin with verse 13. "And they sent to him," speaking of Jesus, "some of the Pharisees and some of the Herodians to trap him in his talk." Now, in this context, the word "trap" here means to acquire information for the purpose to catch someone off guard. Think of a political ad against a candidate that's done by their opponent, where they take some statement out of context, and then they use it against the individual. But who are the they in this verse? Well, if we go all the way back to Mark chapter 11, verse 27, in the previous chapter, we learned that the they refers to the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. These were all religious leaders who are going to now in Mark 12 send the Pharisees and some of the Herodians for this first wave in this verbal sparring match with Jesus. One thing that I want to stand out to you throughout the remainder of Mark chapter 12 is that the Pharisees and the Herodians and the Sadducees were typically quite antagonistic toward each other. So here are three Jewish factions, all of them confronting Jesus. The Pharisees, they opposed the Roman occupation of Palestine. The Herodians, they supported Herod Antipas in Roman policies. The Sadducees, they did not believe in a resurrection. They believed that once a person dies, everything ends. But all three groups were so threatened by the teaching and power of Jesus that they set their differences aside. Sometimes I joke and I say, have you ever wondered why it is that grandparents and grandchildren get along so well? Well, it's because they both have a common enemy. Now, all kidding aside, that's what's happening here in Mark chapter 12 with the enemies of Christ. I like the way that Dr. V, Harvest's theologian in residence, puts it. He says, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. You see, their hatred for Christ was stronger than their disdain for one another. And so they are bound together by this common goal of bringing Christ down. We saw this start all the way back in Mark chapter 3, and it will continue to escalate. And on this day, the Pharisees and the Herodians, they set their differences aside in order to come after Jesus. Look at the beginning of Mark 12, verse 14. And they came and they said to him, "Teacher, we know that you are true and do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances, but truly teach the way of God." So they're trying to butter Jesus up by flattering him. Here's the difference between flattery and gossip. Flattery is saying something to someone's face that you would never say behind their back. Gossip is saying something behind their back that you would never say to their face. And the flattery with which they introduced their question was designed to embolden Jesus to say something against Rome. Look back at verse 14. The rest of it says, "Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay them or should we not?" So this is an either-or question that they ask, and all of us know people who like to ask controversial questions as an either-or, a yes or no, a black or white, when sometimes the answer seems to be gray or it seems to be striped. Today we're going to divide this passage into two sections. Here's the first part. Jesus handles a political question. Is it right for a Jewish person to pay Roman taxes? Now, if Jesus says, oh, it's not right to pay taxes, then the Romans are going to swoop in and they're going to arrest him for treason. But if Jesus says, well, you should pay taxes to Caesar, well, then he runs the risk of the Jewish people turning against him for supporting this imperial tax. So they think they've trapped Jesus. He is between a rock and a hard place. But don't lose any sleep. Jesus was alongside his Father when the world was created. He was there when man was created. And that's why God the Father said, "Let us make man in our own image." You see, Jesus was right there. He created the tongue that speaks and asks such questions. So our Savior isn't sweating. Look at verse 15. But knowing their hypocrisy, Jesus said to them, "Why put me to the test? Bring me a denarius and let me look at it." And they brought one. And he said to them, "Whose likeness and inscription is this?" And they said to him, "Caesar's." The word for hypocrisy that Mark chooses conveys duplicity. It's a facade. It's appearing one way, but being another. And when you see that in a friend, it's quite frustrating to you. May it motivate you to be consistent and genuine in your life. And Jesus is so wise. He's not drawn off sides by this. He immediately responds by saying, bring me a denarius. And a denarius was a coin that at the time was worth a day's wages. And so they quickly produce the coin, and in so doing, Jesus catches them off guard, because it showed that he didn't have one on him, but evidently they did. So they were in no position to criticize Jesus for a lack of patriotism if they themselves were already carrying this idolatrous imperial money. This is a subtle way of proving that they are in no position to try and catch Jesus when Caesar's money is burning a hole in their own pockets. Look down at verse 17. Jesus said to them, "Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." And they marveled at him. Give to Caesar what he deserves, and give to God what he deserves. And the illustration of the coin symbolizes the dependence of the people on the benefits of Roman rule. And when you make that payment of that poll tax, you are agreeing or recognizing your indebtedness to the system, to that system. And you have an obligation to pay it. But Jesus goes on to say, give to God the things that are God's. And that's where the Pharisees struggled. Not technically, not externally, but internally. The Bible says they love to give their gifts in front of people. They followed the letter of the law on giving to God. I mean, they were very meticulous about giving their tithes, even cutting a tenth of a vegetable or herb and giving it to God. They followed the law, but their hearts were far from God. And so Jesus avoids their trap by urging the government to be honored and for God to be obeyed. And it's possible to do both. And the denarius belonged to Caesar. It bore his image on that coin. And people belong to God. And we bear his image. And so you give Caesar what he demands, and you render to God what he deserves. Last week, I loved the way Pastor Eddie talked about how following Christ is an authority issue. We don't like to submit to authority, whether that's a student in a classroom or an employee to their supervisor or a citizen to their governor or their president. But that's at the heart of what God asks us to do, submitting to his plan, to his will. Well, Jesus handles a political question, but here's what else he does. Secondly, Jesus handles a doctrinal question. The Sadducees seek to discredit Jesus' belief in the resurrection as well as his authority as a teacher by asking him a question about the resurrection. Now, you need to know something about the Sadducees. They were a very powerful priestly sect who came from the upper class. They believed that the soul perished when the body died. And while they held especially to the law of the Old Testament, they rejected the oral traditions of the Pharisees. Look at verse 18. And Sadducees came to Jesus, the Sadducees who say that there is no resurrection, and they asked him a question, saying, "Teacher, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies and leaves a wife, but leaves no child, the man must take the widow and raise up offspring for his brother." Now, I don't know about you, but this is starting to sound like an ACT test to me, doesn't it? If you are running 7 miles per hour, and your friend is running 6 miles per hour, and your friend started running an hour ahead of you, when will you catch up with him? The answer is never, because I can't run more than a couple of miles. I mean, that is the correct answer. I did discover that that's not the answer that the ACT people were looking for. Well, the Sadducees have come up with their own ACT question, and it's a rather crazy, convoluted one. And they're going to fake a belief concerning the resurrection in order to try and sincerely ask the question. Listen to the trap that the Sadducees tried to set as they continue. We pick it up in verse 20. Here they go. There were seven brothers. The first took a wife, and when he died, left no offspring. And the second took her and died, leaving no offspring. And the third likewise. And the seven left no offspring. Last of all, the woman also died. In the resurrection, when they rise again, whose wife will she be? For the seven had her as wife. Now, what they're doing is they're referring to something in the Old Testament that's called the Levirate marriage. The Jewish people placed such a high value on the husband being able to have male heirs to pass on his family name. So they took this obscure law and they tried to outlandishly play it out to the seventh degree. And this is all designed to make both the resurrection and Jesus look stupid. They're trying to trap Jesus with Scripture. Can you imagine that? Trapping Jesus with God's Word. But Jesus embodies the Word of God. He fulfilled the law. John chapter 1, verse 14 describes Jesus by saying, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us." Listen to his response in Mark chapter 12, verse 24. Jesus says to them, "Is this not the reason you are wrong? Because you know neither the Scriptures nor the power of God? For when they rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven." So Jesus says, you who are supposed to be so knowledgeable of the Scriptures, he says, you don't know the Scriptures or the power of God. In other words, you have knowledge, but you don't have wisdom. In heaven, you won't be given to marriage like we think of it in this physical, temporary world that we're a part of. And notice that Jesus doesn't say that in heaven we each become angels. He says we will be like angels, meaning in the sense that we will become eternal. And Jesus continues in verse 26, and he further corrects them. He says, "And as for the dead being raised, have you not read in the book of Moses, in the passage about the bush, how God spoke to him, saying, 'I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob'?" And I love the last line that Jesus boldly says to this hostile group. Verse 27, "He is not God of the dead, but of the living. You are quite wrong." Wow. Jesus is so wise. And he knows his questioners. He knows the Sadducees placed a greater value and credibility on the first five books of the Old Testament, what we call the Pentateuch. And so Jesus, so wise, he beats a path to Exodus chapter 3 to drive home that the eternal living God has made eternal covenants with people like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And therefore, those patriarchs who had already died must be alive in some eternal state. And with that, he validates the resurrection. And with that, another group of enemies are left speechless as they walk away, as they set a reminder on their phones to, oh yes, never publicly ask Jesus a question again. What wisdom. Wouldn't you like to have wisdom like that for life's difficult questions? Now, on earth, from this perspective, we can't know everything. That would make us omniscient. And that would make us like God. But remember, he promises that if we ask, he'll give us his wisdom. And we could desperately use some wisdom right now, couldn't we? You know, that being a Christian these days, you will have uncomfortable conversations and have to face difficult questions, just like Jesus. Sometimes they will be doctrinal. Sometimes they will be political. Sometimes they will be issues that, if not handled prayerfully and biblically and humbly, they have the potential to divide our nation and to fracture our communities. And there are no easy answers. There's no simple solution. There's no quick fix to a problem that has been present ever since our nation began. There is one thing that everyone can agree on, and I mean everyone, and that is that George Floyd didn't deserve what he got. He was treated with injustice. His very life was choked out of him by someone who we expect to protect the peace. And there is no excuse for such a tragedy. And sadly, it wasn't the first time that an African American has experienced injustice. And now, with racial tensions reaching the boiling point, a worldwide pandemic has taken a back seat to our nation's Achilles heel. And now, as a country and as communities, we need to confront that racism, and we need to own it, and we need to repent of it collectively. Now, I'm sure there are a lot of ethnicities that at times have felt a similar sting from injustice and suffered the pain of having a lid placed on top of your potential. And that's never right. Racism has always been wrong. It's never God's way. I heard about something that happened around the time that slavery had just ended a few years before in our country. And the ripple effect was still being felt throughout the South. And in a town, there was an African-American man who had fallen on hard times, and he had no food. And he heard of a wealthy white family who may be sympathetic to his plight. And so he went to that house. He walked up the front steps on the porch, and he knocked on the door. And a woman answered the door, and when she saw him, she surmised that he was there for food. And she came out front, and she quickly looked to the neighbor's house on the right, and then she looked to the neighbor's house on the left, and then she whispered to the man, "Meet me on my back porch." And then abruptly, she closed the door. And dutifully, the man went around to the secluded backyard. The woman came out on the back porch, and she handed him a basket of bread, filled with bread for him. And she said to him, "Here you go. Now, before you eat, we need to thank God for our food." And with that, she said, "Repeat after me, 'Our Father who art in heaven.'" And the black man respectfully began to pray, "Your Father who art in heaven." And she stopped him and said, no, just repeat after me, "Our Father who art in heaven." And again, he said, "Your Father who art in heaven." And the woman was obviously perturbed, and she said, "Why do you insist on saying 'your father'?" And the man quietly replied, "Well, ma'am, if he was our father, then that would make us brother and sister. And if we were brother and sister, you wouldn't have made me come back around to your back door." Sometimes we do a good thing, but we don't do the best thing, or we don't do the right thing. During the quarantine, we got pretty good as a nation at socially distancing ourselves from people. Can I tell you something? We cannot continue to social distance from this issue any longer. It's not right. Racism will not go away until it has been dealt with. We can't just keep sweeping it under the carpet and hope that no one trips over it. We can't social distance from this. And hope is not a strategy. We must address injustice before there can be true reconciliation. The fear is real for so many who have felt that for years. Some for decades, some for centuries, that America, one nation under God, has limited their opportunities and been unjust and been made to feel, caused them to feel like they're not a part of the same family. So what am I supposed to do, Dave? What can I do? Well, let me give you three practical steps, and hear me when I say I'm not cavalierly suggesting that if you do these three things that racism will be eradicated. That's not what I'm saying. It won't solve the problem, but at least it will get us moving in the right direction. I appreciate Pastor Ed Ollie so much at Harvest. He has become a dear friend to me. And he shared some thoughts with me that I want to just expound on. Here's three steps. Step one, learn to lament. Weep for our country. Pray for our leaders. The Bible says to rejoice with those who rejoice and to mourn with those who mourn. Love is when your pain lives in my heart. So learn to lament. Secondly, learn to listen. Listen for understanding. Listen with an understanding that says, I want to know how you feel. Listen without talking. And thirdly, learn together. Set out to increase your knowledge of, but more importantly, wisdom of this topic. And put your learnings into actions alongside of others. You know, this past week, there was an email that was sent out to the Harvest family from the teaching pastors. And they did a great job of expounding on this strategy and providing next steps that you can take individually in these areas of lamenting and listening and learning from one another. And when this service is over in just a few minutes, I'm going to invite you to just stay right here online. And it takes about 10 minutes to watch this conversation. And in fact, it will be played right here at the conclusion of the service. You don't need to go anywhere. You don't need to push any other buttons. It's right there, and it's going to remind you, we are one family. You see, your actions and your attitude to those who don't look like you speak louder than any words that you will ever say to them. It's the police officer who steps away from his squad in the midst of a protest to console an angry and emotional adolescent. It's the family of George Floyd saying, please stop the violence. This is taking away from the real issue. It's the peaceful protester who stands in front of a store door that's been bashed in order to try to keep looters out. It's vertical worship. Walking in a peaceful protest in Elgin, just trying to grieve with those who grieve. It's the church who says, no more, no longer. We are equals. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. It's the Christian who gets up early in the morning and goes to buildings that have graffiti all over them. And they pray for their community as they try to erase words that they would never say. Written by people who feel like they have been ushered to the back porch. It's the person who understands the verse that coincidentally Pastor Ed will be teaching on next week in Mark 12, where Jesus says, love your neighbor as yourself. And it starts with you. And it starts with me. And with our families and with our friends and with our neighbors and with our coworkers. And with our church, because a frightened world needs a fearless church with a genuine testimony. And maybe that church hasn't always made the right choice in the past, but they want to make things right, and they want to move in a new direction that is pleasing to God. I love Psalm 133, verse 1. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers and sisters dwell together in unity. May that be true in Chicagoland. May that be true at Harvest. May that be true in our nation. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.
Come awaken your people. Come awaken the city. God of revival, pour it out. Pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. We'll hear the chains hit the ground. So God of revival, pour it out. Pour it out. Hey. Come. Come awaken your people. Come awaken your city. Oh God, a revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. We'll hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God, a revival, pour it out, pour it out. The darkest night, you can light it.
Well, loved ones, let's be praying for our church. Let's be praying for our cities. Let's be praying for our nation. God, help us to love in a greater way this week. Hey, if there's a way that we can pray for you, we would love to be able to do that. Our staff is online right now. You can just click the spot where it says live prayer, and someone will chat with you right away and pray for you right now. We would love to be able to do that. If you're on Facebook or YouTube, you can just click the link there, and we would be happy to reach out to you. We would count it a joy and a privilege to be able to lift up your prayer request to the Lord this week. Hey, two quick reminders before we go. First, men, don't forget about Man of the House. Register today for that. It's coming up Friday the 12th and Saturday the 13th. We want you to be a part of it. And secondly, look out for the survey that's coming after our Sunday services in your email and online. We'd love for you to fill that out so that we can care for you in a greater way. Have a great week in the Lord. You are loved.
Well, hey, Harvest. We wanted to invite you in to hear some of the things that have been our hearts as some of your pastors, because of all that's going around in our country. There's a lot of unrest, there's a lot of anger, there's a lot of tension, and every week, you know, we bring to you God's Word, and we trust that the message that He has for our church is always there. And we're thankful for that, but we also want to share our heart at times on just things that are going on, things that are going on around us. And just to start, I want to say that what we're doing here today is, first, we're not bringing to you this agenda. We're not bringing to you this list of, here's everything you need to feel, here's everything you need to think, and then here's everything you need to do. If agendas were going to take us to the place we wanted to get to, then I think we probably would have already gotten there. And instead, what we want to do today is just show you a bit of relationship, because if change is going to happen, it's going to happen in relationship. Yeah. And I'm thankful that here next to me, I have two brothers, and God doesn't have many families. He has one family. And so because God is our Father, these are my brothers, and we all come from very, very different places. You know, I grew up in Mexico. I'm Mexican American. And, you know, I'll let them kind of speak to their backgrounds too. But we're different, and God made us different. And so we're going to have different perspectives. But we today just want to let you hear our hearts. And maybe I'll just share what's on my heart first, and then I'll hand it to you guys. But I, one of the red flags that went up for me with all that's been going on in our country, and as I've witnessed videos, you know, like last week and seeing George Floyd's video, the red flag that came on my heart was realizing that I naturally had a bent towards being analytical, and I was jumping right away past feeling and seeing what I was seeing to deciding what I thought about it and deciding how I was gonna have an opinion about it and how I was gonna argue with my friends about it. And that really grieved my heart, because out of all the things that I've been learning, even as I've been preaching through the series that we've been doing here through the book of Mark, you guys know that before God lets you be a teacher, he makes you a student, right? And and you know, a few weeks ago I preached on justice and mercy, and how in the kingdom of God, you have to be able to see both those things. And if my opinion, if me trying to figure out what's going on is so important to me that I skip the mercy part, something's wrong.
Yeah.
And I just think the lesson I'm pulling out of this is I have to start with compassion. I have to start with seeing what is happening in our country and acknowledging that any loss of life, any loss of innocent life, should grieve my heart, because every man and woman bears the image of God himself. This is how he made the world. And if it grieves his heart, why isn't it grieving my heart? Well, it's not because I don't think about it. It's because I'm trying to skip it and jump to the next thing. Wow. And I just don't want to be that way. And I don't want us to be that way. I want us to be able to see what's happening and allow our hearts to be grieved by the fact that there is loss. And we have lost people who God made in his image, and things ought not be this way. And so that's really what's been on my mind just this past week. And like I said, we don't have all the answers, and we're not trying to fix everything here, but we can have a conversation here with each other as brothers. So Tommy, I was kind of curious, like, what's been going on with you?
Yeah, so I felt heartache, you know, watching the video, and disgust. Yeah, I'm a little less analytical, a little bit more emotional. I don't display it a ton, but I'm an emotional person. And so my emotions immediately ran to anger, deep sadness, disgust watching that video, and trying to work through that. What is that, you know, what do I do with this emotion? And, you know, I think as a white man from rural Wisconsin, you know, I lived, you know, kitty corner to a cow farm in a cornfield. And I went to school with people, 99% of them who looked exactly like me. And so feeling that sense of a little bit of inadequacy, I didn't really start learning about these issues and this, you know, specific, you know, situation for our brothers and sisters until college. And so it's been a learning experience up until then. And I think the Lord has really pressed on my heart in this season of prayer is the thing in my spiritual table when things get busy or crazy that I tend to push off first. And the Lord's been pressing on my heart to fervently pray. And not just to do that, but to act. Yeah. And in that fervent prayer, I've been praying the Lord's Prayer, which is a very good prayer to pray, you know? And thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Yeah, that's good, Tommy.
And in heaven, there is no racial injustice. In heaven, there is no racial disparity or racial discrimination. All are equal before the Lord our God. And so in this season, I want to stand and support and love our brothers and sisters of color until that statement is true on earth as it is in heaven. What about you, Ed? How have you been feeling through all of this?
I tell you, it's been really challenging. I think there have been days where I've been encouraged as I see the peaceful protest and I see Black, white, Latino, Asian, international, even outside of our country, people grappling with this tragedy. And then there's been days where I've really grappled with righteous anger.
Yeah.
What is it like to be in a country that continues to grapple and be stunted by this issue of racism. And I found myself finding that protest and prayer, they're actually two sides of the same coin. It's something that happens when you passionately cry out to the Lord when you don't know what to do. And then you get up off your knees and then you put into action what the scriptures actually say. And so, for me, I feel like America has always had a racism problem, but we have a greater in the church. We have a theology problem. Mm-hmm. We don't understand that Genesis 2 and 3 says that we're created in the image of God.
Right.
So when I see you as a biracial Mexican American, and I see you as my white brother, I see others, I see myself. I see the image of God. And Matthew 18 has been ringing in my my heart. Jesus in the parables shares about the one sheep that got away. And I didn't see the shepherd yell, "Hey, all sheep matter." You know, that would be foolishness. They all do matter, those sheep do matter. But he left and he went after that one. I feel like we all are going after that one whose life was snuffed out and trying to keep people's focus on. This is a hard journey. And the journey that I've been on for over 30 years has been hard because I'm called into places where I am not the majority. And there's a price for what I say and how I say it. And where I say it. And so being able to be in safety of you two and Pastor Dave Sohn, as we've been just wrestling, grappling with Mark, and it's been really a blessing and a challenge.
Yeah. And I know, you know, everyone listening is probably thinking, like, what can we do? And this is an important point because I see it all the time. We, in our hearts, we feel the burden, and then we feel like, well, we got to do everything to fix this. And then we get overwhelmed because we're like, well, we can't fix it. We can't do everything, but we got to do something. And let's not let the everything get in the way of doing something. And so, maybe, you know, what are some of the things we can do over the next few months to at least take steps forward?
Sure. I think as a church, we feel a responsibility to help people biblically look at this issue as well as grapple in their hearts. And so there's really three things over the next 90 days that we're going to be leading and serving our church in. One, we're going to learn more about what the Bible has to say about lamenting. Nehemiah and Jeremiah are just great examples of this. They didn't hurry and move into action, but they just sat with identifying with the reality of the pain. And I think that there's something that we all can do, regardless of race, in learning to lament. Second thing is we're learning to listen for understanding, not just to be heard. A few weeks ago, I said, listen. Yeah. And then when you're ready to respond, pause and listen some more. Yeah. So we're going to practice that. But the third thing is we're going to learn together. We're going to choose three books. There are many others. But we're going to choose three books, have a little Harvest Book Club once a month, June, July, and August. And we're just going to read together and have some online discussion as we're growing together. And so we want to really take our activism and our anger and our joy, we want to put it into action. We have a long way to go. We've learned a lot as a church, but we have a long way to go. And so we're not in a hurry, but we're going to learn, and we're going to listen, and we're going to lament together. And I know, Tommy, you've been working on some things just personally too.
Yeah, and I mean, you've been a phenomenal help to me in processing and getting these conversations started. And one of the things I was just reading in the book of Philippians, in chapter 4 at the end, Paul says to the Philippian church, "It was kind of you to share in my trouble." Mm-hmm. And so Paul was facing persecution, injustice in the place that he was sharing the gospel. And of course, that's not a one-to-one, it's different, right? But the principle remains the same. And he said to the Philippians, "It was kind of you to share in my trouble." And so I think, and he goes on and talks about the partnership that he has with this group of people and how that's encouraging to him. And I think, you know, in this moment, taking that position of the Philippian church and being kind to our brothers and sisters and sharing in their trouble, we're not experiencing the same trouble, but we can share in it. And really practically, by the ways that you just said, by lamenting, by listening and by learning. And I've started to have great conversations with brothers and sisters and listening, really listening, how they're feeling, what they're thinking, how this affects them. And that has led to, over a course of even just a couple of conversations, learning. And I feel like I've learned more in the past couple of weeks than I have over decades of my life. And it's been really helpful to me, because now I'm learning about the struggle and the trouble of my brothers and sisters in Christ who don't exactly look like me and have been experiencing this deep pain for so long. And so I love that we're doing this as a church together, lamenting and listening and learning. I think it's going to be super beneficial.
Well, and I think it's just so important to see how when you're, even as you're sharing about listening, like I can sense that it requires a humility. And we know God took the time to explain to us that if he's going to show up in grace and pour out his blessing, it's on those who are humbling themselves. Yeah. Instead of the ones who have it all together and have their, you know, lists to check and all that. No. It's humility. It's choosing that lower position before God and others, and then letting the actions flow from that. So that's what I want for our family, and that's what I'm thankful that I get to share with you guys as my brothers. Yeah.